Thank you to the members and leadership of the NCAI for the opportunity to speak with you today and for your long-standing commitment to meeting the greatest challenge of our times. I'm humbled by your partnership as we embark on this critical decade for action. Before I begin any formal remarks, let me acknowledge that I'm joining you from the traditional and ancestral homelands of the Anacostan and Piscataway people in Washington, D.C. Tribal nations' close relationships with the natural world and subsistence lifeways have made the climate crisis immediately palpable in ways that the rest of the world cannot truly understand. You've been on the front lines of climate change for decades, from the coastal communities of the Southern Delta to the Pacific Northwest to the Arctic. Tribal nations have suffered from historic wildfires, devastating drought, sea level rise, and coastal erosion, all while living through year-on-year record-breaking heat. While many suffer through these turbulent events, the impacts on tribal nations have been especially profound. And it's not just the changes to weather and the environment. The changes to food systems, growing seasons, and availability are not only a concern for food security, but also for the inextricable interconnection with identity and culture. We know freshwater salmon and trout hold deep significance for the tribes who rely on them for subsistence, as well as cultural practices and economic development. Native foods and fisheries are declining, and tribal access to traditional foods and medicines is often further limited by reservation boundaries. The specter of deep and irreversible loss, loss of ancestral lands, culture, heritage, and identity, only adds to the physical stresses. Indigenous ways of life that have been sustained across the globe for thousands of years are also on the front lines. Recognizing tribal sovereignty and self-determination is important in its own right. And we know that it is also key for tribal communities to be best equipped and remain resilient in the face of unprecedented change, so that you can make your own decisions on how best to maintain and strengthen your nations and your distinctive spiritual relationship with lands, waters, and coastal seas, and to uphold your responsibilities to future generations. So your resilience is critical for the world. And while indigenous communities are most often the most affected and least resourced to contend with the challenges of a changing climate, tribal ecological wisdom and practices acquired through the accumulation of centuries of practices, beliefs, and distinct interactions with the natural world are increasingly understood as key to addressing both reducing emissions and adapting to inevitable change. So tribal ecological knowledge is really time-tested, sustainable, cost-effective. In the Pacific Northwest, for example, tribes are expanding efforts already underway to minimize the effects of the climate crisis, including regional water quality improvement projects, fisheries restoration, and forest revitalization, including restoring old growth forest systems. Traditional land management can also reduce the risk of devastating forest fires. So we see examples of these critical indigenous adaptations providing broad benefit throughout our country and in other countries as well, like Australia and Brazil. The Biden administration fundamentally believes that honoring our relationship with tribes and upholding our trust and treaty responsibilities are paramount. President Biden not only understands this obligation, but also recognizes the value that indigenous traditions of stewardship bring to the table, including our work to tackle the climate crisis at home and abroad. Substantive engagement and coordination with indigenous and tribal communities is a fundamental pillar of our approach to U.S. climate diplomacy. For my team, listening sessions and briefings before, during, and after global meetings like the critical meetings next month in Glasgow are a key part of our outreach as we look to the next decade of work. 6 years ago, when the Paris Agreement brought countries together, it was an historic show of unity in the face of a global threat. And that is still making a difference today. Since Paris, it has unfortunately become clearer and clearer that we all need to significantly raise our ambition. We're already seeing dramatic impacts, negative impacts at a roughly 1.2 degree centigrade increase in average global temperatures. Yes, all of this that's happening to us now is at 1.2 degrees. And to double that would be absolute catastrophe. So we must focus urgently on keeping a 1.5 degree centigrade limit within reach. Much more warming than that, and life on our planet will become increasingly unrecognizable. Without decisive action and without a recognition that all communities are connected to each other and to our natural world, something you've known for a long time, what lies ahead would then be a world that no one would be content to leave behind for younger generations. So as we consider the needs of future generations, being connected to indigenous peoples throughout the world will remain an absolute priority. We understand from conversations with indigenous partners that you're contending with long-standing challenges, from securing land tenure for indigenous territories, to the criminalization of forest defenders, to the challenge of generalized violence against indigenous communities throughout the globe. At the same time, everyone seeks to be equal partners in the global efforts to address climate change. And I welcome a partnership with all of you, with a core understanding that all of us are inextricably connected to the fate and well-being of the natural world. Indigenous peoples are amongst the very best stewards of lands and waters. Indigenous territories protect a significant portion of the world's forests and have far lower deforestation rates on average than surrounding lands. Indigenous communities also play a crucial role in conservation as stewards of some of the world's most biodiverse ecosystems. And scientists have documented what you already know, that indigenous owned and managed lands often have significantly lower rates of ecological decline. Supporting indigenous and local knowledge and investing in indigenous communities is absolutely critical to protecting Earth's remaining intact ecosystems and to addressing the climate crisis. Nature has been doing the hard work in the fight against climate change, with the ocean and forests providing nearly all of our carbon removal. They've taken the heat literally for decades and have suffered the consequences. The good news is, when given the chance, nature often recovers. For these reasons, it's critical that we place nature at the heart of addressing the climate crisis, from ecosystem restoration and conservation to sustainable agriculture and aquaculture. Nature and community-based solutions are an essential part of how countries around the world need to now address the climate crisis. The health and presence of indigenous peoples is inextricably linked to the health of the planet. When indigenous languages and cultures are lost, and when indigenous communities are removed from their lands, traditional knowledge about the world we live in is irrevocably lost as a result. To that end, we support efforts like the Local Communities and Indigenous Peoples Platform, which is on the agenda for Glasgow. The platform was established to foster the exchange of experiences and sharing of best practices on mitigation and adaptation in a holistic manner, with a focus on knowledge exchange, capacity building, and integration of indigenous knowledge in climate policies and actions. As we advance our thinking on how to harness the role of forests, oceans, and other ecosystems more effectively to address a rapidly changing climate, we will look forward to working with you to design effective solutions. I'm also happy to know that our delegation will include the first Indigenous cabinet member, Secretary Haaland. Secretary Haaland's participation at COP26 will help to ensure that the U.S. delegation represents the full diversity of our country. Her participation will help highlight the importance of full engagement, empowerment, and integration of the traditional knowledge of Indigenous peoples who face the gravest climate change impacts. She will also elevate nature-based solutions to climate change and conservation measures that build ecosystem resilience. My friends, time is running out, and Glasgow is the time, the moment, and the place to get the world aligned. I look forward to exploring how we can facilitate ongoing dialogue and to learning more from you as we continue to develop our climate strategy. We recognize fully that tribal nations are uniquely situated to help the world save us from the climate crisis. And we acknowledge that to support and partner with tribal nations and empower Indigenous peoples globally, we must continue to respect tribal sovereignty and self-determination and to work with you to protect your lands and resource rights. Humanity is facing one of the biggest challenges of our time. With your partnership, our world can usher in a new era in which we restore balance to our natural world and to meet this moment and to move our planet toward a more sustainable future. That's the challenge. We need your help. We need to work together. Thank you.